Right now, though, let's turn our attention to our next guest, the Transport Secretary, Grant Shapps. Good morning to you.
Morning.
Good morning. Very busy time for the government, no doubt at all. Those repatriation flights are being a very big concern. We understand this is, the biggest peacetime repatriation. How soon do we think that we can actually get all of those British citizens back to the UK?
Well, I think this programme will probably run for a month or so. It's huge. I handled the Thomas Cook, then the biggest repatriation. This is bigger than the Thomas Cook repatriation because people are spread all around the world. We don't have the passenger number records as we did with a single airline. People have been there for lots of reasons over lots of periods of time. And so I'm going to be completely upfront. It's going to be big, it's going to be messy, and it's going to be complicated. But we are working very hard to try to bring British nationals home who want to be returned home.
And what preparations are being made for there to be quarantine for some of these people who are coming from countries where they may well have been infected with coronavirus? Obviously, we've got a lot of people infected here, but there's lots of concern that our airports aren't actually testing people, not taking temperatures, and not putting people into quarantine. Are we not putting the British population at more risk with people returning from far-flung places with the virus?
So essentially, because where we are in this disease now, everybody effectively will go into quarantine. That's the first thing people will do. They'll be in the same position as the rest of us, not leaving home like you and I. And that will be the situation for them as well. And although it sounds simplistic to sort of take someone's temperature, the chief medical officer, the chief scientific officer are saying it's interesting but of relatively limited benefit because it often doesn't pick it up. You can have a temperature for many different reasons. The best thing for people to do is simply to get themselves home and stay in, which is, of course, what we should all be doing.
Yeah, indeed. Now, obviously, there's also talk about transport within this country. Public transport use has been down 90%, particularly in the epicentre of the coronavirus outbreak in London. London Tube use down that amount as well. Obviously, big concern for the bus companies who are now saying that they're going to need a bailout. Similar to that, you offered to the rail companies last week. What help are you going to be able to offer the bus company and other transport organisations who need help?
Yeah, I mean, you're right about the scale of the reduction. I mean, it's actually 96% on the London Tubes now and 89% on National Rail. It's a huge reduction. I must be the first Transport Secretary in history who actually wants our transport network to be used less. And it shows that we're winning when we do that. But you're right. We've sort of put the railways onto a stable footing so they can carry on getting the key workers to work. The buses obviously are essential. 55% of all public transport are buses. And so I am working hard on ensuring that they're able to continue through this crisis and get onto a stable footing afterwards. I'll be saying more about that in the coming days.
Okay, can you clarify for us who is and who is not allowed to travel to and from work? Sadiq Khan, the London Mayor, has been sending out a number of tweets saying that only essential key workers are allowed to use public transport. However, the government guidance is very clear. Travelling to and from work, but only where this absolutely cannot be done from home, is one of the reasons people are allowed to leave the home. So you don't have to be an essential, a key worker, a frontline worker to be allowed to leave home to go to work. Is that the case?
That is the case. And you're absolutely right to point out the difference in message there. The government is quite clear. You leave home if you're a key worker and you can go to work if it's impossible for you to work from home, whilst encouraging everyone to work from home if that is at all possible. And people are finding more and more innovative ways to do that in jobs where they perhaps didn't think they were able to in the past. But there will be some jobs that you cannot do from home. And the government has been clear that those people are, in fact, able to travel in order to do their job and bring in their income.
OK, do you think there's been a little bit too much middle class people on their laptops able to work from home, finger pointing at people who have the sort of jobs where you can't do your job from the study or from the kitchen table? You do need to actually go out, whether you're a cleaner, whether you're a construction worker, whatever job you do, where you actually need to physically be on the premises. Do you think there's been a little bit too much curtain twitching and finger pointing?
Yeah, I think because the government's line is actually very clear on this, but as just discussed, you can go to work if you cannot work from home. And why? Because we respect people's livelihoods and that people will, and we don't want to sort of crash the economy and create even more problems by doing so. That will lead to many more social problems and health problems as well. So it's getting that balance right. And this advice isn't random advice. We have asked the chief medical officer and the chief scientific officer to tell us what we should be doing, which categories should be allowed to work, and then we've followed that advice. So it's not random advice. So to go to your question, rather than listening to what, as you describe, a curtain twitcher says, we should listen to the experts. But the key message of staying at home, if you possibly can, remains totally central, is vital, because that's how we protect the NHS from being overwhelmed and, you know, ultimately save lives by doing that as well.
Can we also just clarify what are and what are not essential items to be purchasing? There's been some criticism of the police that people have been told off for buying chocolate Easter eggs, and small shops, corner shops being told off for selling Easter eggs as non-essential items. Someone apparently, again, we see reports of this, being given a fine for buying a birthday card while they were in the supermarket buying other items. Do you think these are essential items, and should the police perhaps be showing a little bit more common sense?
Yeah, I mean, the government's been clear about this as well, actually. What we've said is, if you are, buying essentials, or if you are, take it the other way around, if you're a shop selling essentials, so we've said the types of shops that can remain open, and the stock in the shop is yours to sell, particularly if it's food, you of course can sell it. But I don't want to be super critical of the police either here, because I think they are doing an incredible job under unbelievable circumstances. And whilst I'm sure there have been a few overzealous examples, actually generally the public's complying, and that's how we're seeing those massive reductions in the number of people using our public transport. That proves it. Most people want to make this work, and are doing that. And we shouldn't use the exception to prove a rule with regard to, the police. Won't always get it exactly right,
okay,
but they are trying their hardest.
Just finally, in terms of getting it exactly right, we're supposed to have a testing target now for antibody tests for the coronavirus of 10,000. On Sunday, fewer than 5,000 tests were carried out. Still concerns that frontline NHS staff are not getting the personal protective equipment, the PPE, that they need. Are you confident that the government, I know it's a testing time, I know it's very difficult, there's a lot to get on the government to get on its plate, but are you confident that the government is on top of getting all the right equipment that we need to tackle this virus?
Yeah, I mean, those antibody tests, of course, are the ones I think that will tell whether you've had the disease, and that is the sort of nirvana of this process, to be able to tell if you've had it, because that potentially would lead to a route out of the lockdown if you had already had it but perhaps didn't know or was very mild. But the more broad, the general upfront test, we are working very, very hard to ramp that up. We're just opening 3 new testing centres, and it's our objective to get that up to 25,000 a day, in particular to ensure people on the front line, the NHS staff doing such an incredible job, are tested. It is true to say this is an enormous challenge, and every health system in the world is under pressure with it. Ours has responded, for example, brilliantly by building in the Docklands there what will be the Nightingale, the world's biggest hospital, we hear.
It's not the world's biggest hospital. It's got 4,000 beds. No, I believe Taiwan's got one with 10,000.
Oh, have they? Okay, I got that from the BBC. I do apologise.
Oh, well, there you are then. That will serve you right. Should listen to reputable news organisations.
There it is. Certainly a very large hospital, and more of those, one in Birmingham, one in Manchester as well, which is an enormous, military style. In fact, a military response to this crisis. And we're trying to do that from the testing to the 170 million pieces of protective equipment that have gone out this last few days, to building new hospitals. I have to be completely straight with you. It is an enormous effort, and it is straining the system to do. And the way that the public listening to this can help is by staying home, because that is the thing which will protect the NHS and save lives.